So as we come in and prepare for worship, let us center ourselves on this Christ the King Sunday. All hail the power of Jesus' name, and angels prostrate fall.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. So welcome this Christ the King Sunday, sometimes known as the Reign of Christ Sunday. So I welcome you to Bradley Hills. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we are so glad to have you. Whether you're in the sanctuary or you're worshiping with us online, we welcome you and invite you to reach out to us and contact us so that we may visit with you after the service, or those who are online can email me at denise@bradleyhillschurch.org, or you may contact Pastor David Gray, the senior pastor, at david@bradleyhillschurch.org. David is traveling today, but he will be in the office tomorrow. So we have a lot of announcements. First of all, I want to welcome Jen out. We are so pleased to have you worshiping with us this morning, and we're looking forward to hearing you praise the Lord this morning. We're tickled to death about our Alleluia singers, and the Ringers were back in the service today. So I was sending an email to Matthew this week saying that I was looking forward to just all of the glorious ways that we are able to celebrate with music. So praise the Lord for just the very talented people in our congregation. And it takes a lot of courage if there's three of you to stand here and sing, but I think the children enjoy it. So let's encourage them. So I would like to call your attention to some of the announcements in our bulletin. The Advent starts next Sunday. It will be the first Sunday of Advent, and we generally have a candle lighting litany. So those, if there are any members of the congregation, if your family would like to help out with that at the beginning of worship, as part of the call to worship, would you please get in touch with David at his email address. In terms of Bible study, I want to remind people that there will not meet Bible study this week, but David will be back on November the 30th. We also, next Sunday, because it is the first Sunday of Advent, to continue the tradition that we normally have of doing a brief labyrinth walk, that will be outside at the labyrinth at 9:30. So you could just meet me outside at 9:30 at the labyrinth, and we'll have a little short devotion about the idea about the labyrinth, and then individually we will walk. So it's a wonderful spiritual experience. If you've never done it before, don't feel intimidated. It's not hard. So just come on out and we'll just all do it together. There will be a tree lighting service. Well, actually it's just tree lighting and carols on December the 4th at 5 p.m. Those of you who attended last year will remember, we just had a delightful time. Matthew played for us so that we could sing carols outside, and it was just wonderful. So it really was nice for me because I was used to doing carols with my home church back in Long Beach, California. And I was feeling a little nostalgic about missing that, so this completely replaced it, and it was delightful. So come out on December the 4th. And following the candle lighting, the youth will be having their chili cook-off. So it's a chili cook-off and a bake-off, and there'll be games and prizes, and so you won't want to miss that. In addition, poinsettias and Christmas cacti are back, so see the announcement in your bulletin about how to contact Bea or Pam Hammers in order to place your orders for the Christmas plants that will decorate the chancel during that time. We are entering or have entered our seasons of joyful giving, and so there's announcements about how you can participate in that. We will have a minute for mission regarding Angel Gift Tree in a minute, but there's lots of news for you in your bulletin about the joyful seasons of giving. And I think that's about all. The stewardship campaign is underway and about almost kind of wrapping it up. So if you have not made a financial commitment to the church for 2023, please consider doing so. It allows our budgeting, our finance committee to be able to better plan in terms of our budget when they know for sure what they have commitments to work with for the coming year. So with that, I will turn it over to Melissa Callis.
Good morning, everybody. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Melissa Callis, and I grew up in this church. And when I was a kid, I got an allowance, and it was a dollar. We're going to leave commentary about inflation and what allowances might be today to the side, but back then it was a dollar. And a quarter of it would go to help pay for school lunches, because that was a special treat every week. A quarter of it would go into our savings. A quarter of it would be fun money. And the final quarter would be for charity. And my brother and I had the option of putting that quarter for charity into the plate at church every week, or saving it to help make Christmas magic. And I bet you can kind of pick which, guess which one, you know, like the eight-year-old would pick, like church, Christmas magic, church, Christmas magic. We typically would pick Christmas magic, but that was also through the church. And every year, we would come in late November, early December, and we would go and pick a kid's name off of the angel gift tree. And I recognize as a five-year-old, we would typically pick a five-year-old. We'd go find somebody, and we would pull out our quarters and maybe some birthday money or something from a lemonade stand. We put all that money together and be like, we're gonna make Christmas magic. We would pull out the kid's name, what they asked for, and yes, the flyer from Toys R Us that came in the Sunday newspaper to say, will Toys R Us have the Cabbage Patch doll? Or will it have the book that they're looking for? I recognize that 30 years later, those traditions might have changed. I don't think Toys R Us is around anymore. We're gonna leave that also to the side because it makes me sad. And you might be looking at Amazon instead. But I'll admit, my traditions have changed a little bit as well. I still do the angel gift tree, but I'm not pulling out the quarters from my allowance anymore. I'm coming, I'm picking a kid's name, or in this case, maybe a senior, to help pick them a gift and make it Christmas magic. I am saying that I want to make sure that they have the same joy that I, or the experience that I had, whether it was wrapping a present to put underneath their Christmas tree, or now, taking a photo of the gift that I picked and wrapped probably a little bit better than I did as a six-year-old, and giving it to my parents and saying, hey, this is what I'm giving to you today. You're getting the joy of imagining a nine-year-old opening, actually I just bought it this morning, a graphic novel and a science kit. My dad will probably ask if he can also have a science kit, and my mom will go, let's open the next present. So I invite you guys today, after the service, stop by the tables in Covenant Hall. And for those of you online, there should be a link that you can click to support through a wider circle. Pick a kid, pick a senior citizen, and help bring them some Christmas magic. Thanks, everybody.
I invite you to join me in the prayer of adoration and confession, followed by a time of silence for your own personal confessions. God of glory, we do not always see your glory in the world around us. When we see a person in need, it is not easy to look them in the eye. When we hear a cry for help, it is not easy to offer quick assurance. When we know of a lonely prisoner, it is not easy to make that unannounced visit. Forgive us when we fail to see you in our everyday lives. Forgive us when we are afraid to act, afraid to care. Encourage us, God of glory. Help us to see others with the eyes of compassion, that we might be your loving presence in the world. Amen. the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Well, good morning. Good morning, everyone. Oh, come on and join us. We're happy to have you. Oh, wow. Can we scoot down some so we can make room? Can you sit right here? You want to sit here? Okay. All right. You want to sit right there? Oh, we're so happy to have you. Somebody wants you to come over here with them. Okay. All right. So, you heard Melissa just a few minutes ago, remember, talk about how she had quarters for the angel gift tree, and she used her quarters from her allowance to buy presents during Christmas, during what we call the seasons of giving. And I really liked her idea about how she did that. When my children were younger, I used to take my youngest son especially. There was at our church, we didn't have angel gift tree. We had what was called Doors of Faith Orphanage. And so there would be a picture of a child, and our family would go to the table and select the picture of the child. And then we would buy a gift for that child. So my son got to pick it out. And most of the time he would look for a child that was his age. And so we still have the picture of that very first child that we selected at that church that we were attending. His name was Jesus, and he was 4 years old. And we bought this big, big Tonka fire truck. And Benjamin liked it so much, we were thinking, well, we should get him one too. So we got the truck for Jesus, and we wrapped it up and took it to church. But we also bought one for Benjamin, and I'm going to share with you, this summer when I visited Benjamin, who is now a grown man and has children this age, that we still had that fire truck that he had, and I took it to his house, and now my grandson is playing with the truck that Benjamin bought one just like for Jesus. So yesterday, I went shopping, because we are having angel gift tree at our church. So I picked two names. The first name, his name is Iker, and he wanted a gift certificate. And so I got a gift certificate because he said he wanted to pick out his own shirt and some pants and a graphic novel. So on Christmas, Iker will be able to do that. Hope Iker's not here because I don't want him to know. But I also bought this, so you figure a gift card couldn't go. I mean, I don't need a gift card for this big a package, right? But you hear that? Those are Kit Kats. It's a whole big box of Kit Kats. So in addition to a gift card, Iker's gonna get all these gift Kit Kats. So would somebody like to put the So we have the table over here, and we're going to have this table for next week and the following week. And when you see a green tag, so when you go today to pick out somebody to get a gift for, you'll either get a purple paper or a green paper. And when you bring the gift back wrapped, I need to put a bow on this, but anyway, you bring it back, and you put the gift on the color of the table where that matches the color of the tag. Would somebody like to put this gift over on the table for me? Okay, thank you. Can you carry that? It's not too heavy for you.
Also, I think I may have accidentally mixed up my gift, so I think I'm gonna go change. I brought gifts, and my brother and sister brought gifts, and I think we missed the gift.
Well, that's okay. We'll work it out. We'll work it out. All right. And then Melissa was saying about senior citizens. Do you know what a senior citizen is? What's a senior citizen?
It's a person who has been in the city and is who's been in the city or a place very long.
Very long. All right. Very long. Yes. Yes.
Can I carry it?
You think you could carry this? Do you need some help? It's kind of heavy. Is that too heavy? Okay, so you're going to, it's as big as you. Can you put it on the green table? So that was a gift for a senior citizen. And she wanted some mittens to keep her warm. And she also wanted some other personal items. And so it was just a real joy yesterday. Thank you. You were such a big help. It was such a joy yesterday to go shopping. So I hope that after church, you'll go to the table out in the gathering space in Covenant Hall and pick a name and then go shopping with your parents. And then over the next couple of weeks, you can bring your gift and know that you're being part of Christmas magic for somebody else. Okay? Can you be part of Christmas magic? Okay, all right. So, let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for all the gifts that you give to us.
We thank you for
the opportunity to share so that we might be a blessing and participate in Christmas magic that begins with your son, Jesus. Amen. All right, so we say, may the peace of Christ go in peace. All right?
Good morning. Today's scripture lesson is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 31 through 45. Hear these words. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him. And he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. Then he will say to those on his left hand, you who are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it for one of the least of these, you did not do it for me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please join me in prayer. That Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Today we are going to, or it's my attempt to talk about Christ, a different kind of king, a different kind of kingdom. Today we celebrate what we refer to as Christ the King Sunday. It's the church festival of Christ the King, or the reign of Christ, and it signals the end of the liturgical year of the Christian calendar. It transitions us to the season of Advent and the beginning of a new liturgical year. The festival of the Christ the King Sunday is a fairly recent addition to the liturgical calendar. Pope Pius XI established this festival in 1925 as a response to the rising tide of secularism and nationalism around the globe. And it reminds me even today of the secularism and nationalism and Christian nationalism that we're experiencing here in the United States and other places around the world. Originally, the festival was celebrated on the last Sunday of October prior to All Saints' Day, but it was later moved to the Sunday before the first Sunday of Advent to emphasize that we await the final coming of Christ. For most of us, as I said, it ushers in Advent, the season of hope. Christ is the King. Christ is the King. What is the meaning of this kingship of Christ? First, we begin to understand the meaning of the kingship of Jesus by looking at how Jesus was misunderstood by others. At the birth of Jesus, King Herod misunderstood and thought that Jesus was a new contender to his throne. And that was initiated when the three kings from the east came to worship Jesus and was looking for the king of the Jews. Now, when those kings failed to go back to Herod to report Jesus's whereabouts, Herod ordered the killing of all the boy babies 2 years and under. He didn't want a contender or a threat to his power and to his place as king. The scribes and Pharisees misunderstood the teachings of Jesus and accused him of fraternizing with sinners and tax collectors, accused him of breaking the Sabbath, and worst of all, blasphemy. After feeding the 5,000, the crowd misunderstood Jesus and wanted to make him king because he had given them bread to satisfy their temporary hunger. The disciples of Jesus even misunderstood him and argued about who would be first in his kingdom. And then one of the thieves beside Jesus on the cross misunderstood the meaning of Jesus' power when he heckled Jesus to use his power to save himself. We begin to understand the meaning of the kingship of Jesus by looking at how Jesus was misunderstood by others. But secondly, we begin to understand the meaning of the kingship of Jesus by looking at how Jesus responded to those who misunderstood his purpose. When the scribes and Pharisees challenged Jesus, he confronted them with the truth and continued to do the will of God who sent him. He did not come to basically abandon the law. He was the fulfillment of the law. When the crowd from the feeding of the 5,000 wanted to make Jesus king, he left them and went to be alone in the mountains because he did not come to be their king, not to give them temporary satisfaction, but to give them the bread of life, which would last eternally. Although that they were witness to the sign or the miracle that demonstrated who Jesus was, that was feeding the 5,000 out of 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they did not understand that it was God who made it possible. They were only interested in the fact that their stomachs were filled. When Jesus overheard his disciples arguing about who would be first in the kingdom, he first taught his disciples that the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as ransom for many. Then Jesus demonstrated this that he taught by his own actions, even to the death on the cross. When questioned by Pilate, Jesus did not say that he was a king, but he told Pilate that he had a kingdom, but that his kingdom does not belong to this world. His kingdom was not from here. And then when heckled by the thief and others in the crowd, Jesus prayed for them, asking God to forgive them, for they didn't know what they were doing. In all of these things, there's a sense that Jesus responds in love, which was part of the theme of the song that Jenout just sang. So we begin to understand the meaning of the kingship of Jesus by looking at how Jesus responded to those who misunderstood his purpose. And then lastly, we understand the meaning of the kingship of Christ and who will join him in his kingdom through his last public message, which Frank read to you earlier from the Gospel of Matthew. This passage is often referred to as the least of these message. Unlike most of the teachings of Jesus, this text was not a parable. Rather, Jesus is using a dramatic, apocalyptic vision of the last judgment to reinforce what matters in the end is whether one has acted with compassion and care toward people in need. That self-giving care for others is what God calls us to do. This is the message that Christ had taught for 3 years, by word and by deed. The vision that was read in our hearing begins with the enthronement of the Son of Man in all his glory, surrounded by his angels. So we notice that the author of Matthew begins by using the title Son of Man that is associated with Jesus. However, he doesn't use it anymore in that text. He simply replaces it with the king. So that was to let us know that the Son of Man is this king, that Jesus is who we are talking about. The vision continues that the king begins to separate the people as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, placing the sheep on the right and the goats on the left. The text says that the king will call those on his right hand blessed, and then will invite them to inherit the kingdom that has been prepared for them. Why are they invited? The king says it is because of their care and compassion for him. The king explains, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. Wow. Surprised, those on the right asked, When did we do these things for the king? The king replied, when you did it to one of the least of these of mine, you did it to me. The king subsequently will turn to those on the left and condemn them. They'll be condemned to the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels because they did not show compassion and caring to the king. They also show surprise, confusion even. Those on the left ask, when did we not do these things for you? The king will reply, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. So in his book, Burying White Privilege, Reverend Dr. Miguel de la Torre, who is a professor of social ethics and Latinx studies at the Iliff School of Theology in Denver, Colorado, he offers a contemporary illustration of the text that I've kind of updated to reflect our community. So when the king talks about being hungry, those who have participated in smart sacks or Dorothy Day feeding or preparing Thanksgiving baskets would be those on the right. Those who voted to eliminate supplemental nutrition assistance program would be on the left. When asked about those who were thirsty, we would say that when you provide someone with clean, safe drinking water, or donate through alternative gifts or some other charity to dig a well in a village in Africa, that would be providing water or drink for those who are thirsty. However, if one condemns the people in Flint, Michigan to continue to rely on lead-tainted faucets, that would be the people on the left. And then there's the stranger. How did we welcome or not welcome the stranger or the alien without proper documentation? Well, perhaps you helped to furnish apartments for refugees. Perhaps you tutored the refugee so that they could learn English and then go on to claim, be able to take the test for citizenship. Or perhaps you supported the path of citizenship for DACA children who came here without any control of their own. But maybe you also participated in busing migrant families to cities around the country for media attention. That would not be one that helped or cared for those that were a stranger. And then there's looking at those who needed clothes or were naked. Perhaps you made personal toiletry kits for migrants or for those who have been affected by bad weather. But then there might be some who have criminalized people's appearance by passing anti-vagrancy laws that make them feel hostile and unwanted in certain communities. As far as taking care of the sick and the infirmed, perhaps you worked to create sustainable medical systems that would heal a person. Perhaps you contributed to one of the four alternative gifts that is providing medical aid to various communities within our community and around the world. Or maybe you attempted to circumvent federal medical care for people who could not afford it. And then there are those who are in prison. Perhaps one sought to develop a just judicial system that was not dependent on profiting off the existence of brown and black bodies. Or maybe, again, you contributed to alternative gifts that is providing legal aid for people who don't have the resources to provide it for themselves. Or perhaps, on the other side, one might have helped to privatize the prison system, which profits from maintaining high brown and black occupancy. So it was, the question was asked, it was surprise. Both were surprised, those on the left and those on the right. How did we do this to you? And the king replied, when you did it to the least of these, you did it for me. When you did not do it to the least of these, you did not do it for me. In his last public teaching, Jesus stressed to his followers that those in his kingdom join him in expressing solidarity with the dispossessed and those in great need through merciful action. Dr. De La Torre suggests that the radical call of the gospel is a political call for justice. So what is the meaning of the kingship of Christ? First, we understand that the meaning of the kingship of Christ, we can understand it better by looking at the ways that people misunderstood Jesus and the kingdom of God. Secondly, we can understand the meaning of the kingdom and kingship of Christ by looking at the ways that Jesus responded to those who misunderstood him. And lastly, we understand the meaning of the kingship of Christ when we come to understand that Christ is a different kind of king in a different kind of kingdom. In the kingdom of God, where Christ is king, what matters is a compassionate, caring response to human need. And why is that? Because when we serve one another, we are serving God. May it be so for you, and may it be so for me. Amen. Be seated. This is a time that we have the opportunity to offer our gifts, our tithes and our offerings. We know that all that we have comes from God, and so we give back a portion, knowing that we can't beat God giving, because the more we give, the more God gives to us. The ushers may come forward. seated. This is the time that we offer our prayers and concerns, our concerns and celebrations. So would you join me in prayer? And at the appropriate time, if you have a prayer or concern that you would like to share, please feel free to say it aloud, or hold it in your heart and know that even the prayers that we do not hear aloud, that we ask the Holy Spirit to pray for us, for all those that are being expressed that we don't know specifically what the concern is. Gracious God, we come to you this morning just on the cusp of change, that we come knowing that this is Christ the King Sunday, and yet we know that there are parts of the world and parts of our own individual hearts that this remains hidden. And so we have faith that ultimately that Christ will be celebrated and Christ's love will be spread to all. And so we come knowing that our world is in trouble, that there are not just rumors of wars, but there are wars in places that needless killing goes on and people are just bound to exercise their power. That we don't call people kings now, maybe they have other titles, but that they are interested not in being a servant to others, not in serving, not in the wholeness of their people, but only in their own power and what elevates them. And so, Lord, we come to you this morning asking that you enter into our hearts so that as we come before you, that you may say, blessed, that you belong in my kingdom because of how you share and care for those who are disadvantaged, that we share and care for those who are dispossessed and those who are persecuted. And so, Lord, while we have things that we are grateful for during this time of Thanksgiving and as we continue to experience our seasons of giving, we know that all are not in the same place. And so we remember that not all will be sitting around a table this next week with lots of food to eat. And so we offer what we can to support those who do not have food to eat, who will be hungry. And we ask that you bless us to be more compassionate and more thoughtful and more giving, that we see your light, we see the vision of Christ in all that we meet and all who pass by our way. And so we also pray for places that are in war, that are war-torn, that people are freezing, that that things are very hard for them. And so we know that you have given those strength to fight the battle as David fought Goliath. And so we trust that in the end, righteousness and justice will prevail. And within our congregation, we lift up those who are ill, we lift up those who are recovering from surgery, and we especially lift up those who are mourning the loss of a loved one during this season, that this may be the first big holiday that they are without their loved ones. And so we ask for prayers for the families of those students who were killed during the school shooting on November the 13th. We ask for prayers for the family of Frank Tenney, who passed away this past week. We ask for prayers for the family of Carol McLeod's brother David, who will be celebrated on the 24th of this month. Lord, while we have our concerns, we also are concerned about our Jewish siblings who have been targets of recent graffiti and expressions of anti-Semitism. We are concerned about our LGBTQIA brothers and sisters who have been targeted in Colorado just this last night that have left people dead and many wounded. That where we are afflicted by expressions of hate, Lord, we ask that you weed that out of our society so that all can live in peace. We pray for those who are experiencing cancer, who are living with cancer and are being treated for cancer. Please remember them, and we ask for your healing hand. We are grateful for those who have come home from rehab. So we thank you for rehabilitation, that Phyllis Sutherland is back home. We pray for Jean Eagleton, for Paul Lewis, for Ed Everett, and Joan Brown, and Nancy Taylor, and Yusuko Say. We pray for Angelica, and we pray for Kay and Allison and Mark and David. And we pray for those that maybe we have not lifted up their names. And Lord, while we have those things that we grieve and that we are concerned about, we celebrate new life in marriage. And so we lift up Chris Allen and his new bride, Lucy Ames. And we give thanks for the expressions of unity that we had last week with our interfaith service, and we thank you for Jen Out being here today. And we are just grateful for the ways that we express care and concern within our community. And then we welcome and are grateful for Elizabeth Bullock, who has joined us this week. So with these many expressions of care, but these expressions also of celebration, we leave a time and space for those in our congregation to lift up those with whom they're concerned about. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. So with this, we lay all our prayers before you, prayers of celebration, prayers of concern, and we ask this all in the name of the one that you have sent to us, Christ the King, and we pray with the words that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. go forth. I just want to, first of all, wish all of you, ever how you are spending it, and in whatever menus that you share on Thursday, that you enjoy and that you have a wonderful, gracious, a blessed, happy Thanksgiving. And so I just, it's a time that is oftentimes painful for people. And so we recognize that, but at the same time, on the one hand, we have we have concerns and things that pain us, but in the midst of that, we have joys that come along to help to elevate that. And one of those joys is the joy of memory. And so for those of us who will not actually be physically present with those that we love, for whichever reason it is, that we have memories of good times with them. And so may those good times bring us joy this week as we celebrate. One more thing is that during the 8:30 service, someone shared about, we talked today about when we are in prison, how whether you visit a person, and that person shared that prison isn't necessarily behind bars, that people are imprisoned and with illness sometimes, that they're safe, they have to stay in their homes because they're not able to get out, that people are imprisoned with Alzheimer's or dementia as we age. And so as we think about those people, we offer prayers for them, but we can also reach out because our presence means a lot, and it's the way that we show love. And so I would charge you this day to remember that Christ is a different kind of king. In Bible study, we talked about what do kings look like, and there's a passage in, I think it's 1 Samuel, that talks about when God warned the people of Israel what a king would do. And so these were all, things that were burdensome and were not in their interest. And so Jesus is the image of a servant king. Jesus is the one who comes alongside as like a shepherd. And so when we think about Christ the king, we don't think about all these authoritarian kind of despotic images. We think about a loving shepherd who is there to care for us and to offer us love so that we can share that with one another. So I charge you that as you think about Jesus being a different king of a different kind of kingdom, that you endeavor through your own actions to pay heed to his instructions to us, that just as we do to the least of these that belong to him, and all of us belong to him, whether we look like each other on the outside or not, we all belong to Christ. And so as we move forward and be part of this kingdom of Christ, that we care with compassion and love for one another. And so with that, may the love of, as I was preparing for this, Christ the King Sunday is a relatively new in some church communities, even Protestants, that share it. And as I was preparing for this service, I was just so overjoyed with my own understanding increasing about what it means about Christ the King and how we are called to live out his message of care and compassion in the world. And at the same time, I'm glad that they moved it from October to the Sunday before Advent, because it reminds us that yes, we live now in the presence of Christ because Christ did come. We sing at Christmas, and we'll be singing it next week, I think. Come thou, a long expected Savior. Ever how it goes, I get it twisted sometimes. And Christ came, but we know that Christ. We also live in the time that Christ is coming again. And so Advent isn't just a rehearsal of something that happened before, This Sunday, Christ the King, that's ushering in Advent, reminds us that the love and the joy and the hope and the peace that Christ brings is being ushered in again. And so as we await the second coming of Christ, that we live into that hope. And so I charge you that may the love of God and may the grace of Christ and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you not just this day, but every day from now through eternity. Amen. So as you leave, would you please greet somebody next to you? So offer the peace of Christ, and so as I extend to you, may you extend it to others. May the peace of Christ be with you. Thank you.